today's topic that has been selected is mainstream Ayurveda. And I have given you lectures in Ayurveda in various places in India itself. Currently, I mentioned that Ayurveda is not only a science of medicine, but it is number one, the science of food study and athletics, the study of austerity and principles of life, that is achara, the study of the composition and configuration of human body and its functions in the forms of physiology, anatomy and pathology, etc. So a complete understanding of everything that is to do with human life survival is joy, mental rest, harmony, is longevity, liberation, everything is included in Ayurveda. Ayurveda means life, and life is something very deep when compared to the other words known as health or something. If it is concerned with life, it deals with the person's productivity, the person's fertility, the person's ability to think and perform, and the person's reason or the purpose of its survival itself, which can fetching the opportunities to know God and to seek salvation. So Ayurveda means one, life. Life is a contract between a temporary sojournment of a driving force inside a capable componential bulk. The capable componential bulk is known as body, and the temporary element or entry element is known as Ayuh. So where do you come from, what are you going to do, how you are going to achieve, and what is your next step, the repatriation or salvation. So it is something philosophical, it is something more deep. If the modern medicine, it is deeper in the sense of identifying gene codes, DNA codes, programming languages, their expressions, their consequences, these which I have narrated today in nanobiology lecture. So modern science is deeper in a different sense, that it deals with the micro as well as impalpable dimensions which are there to our normal human observation. Those things are explained there. But more than that, the deeper things are considered in the Ayurveda. So we can say that modern medicine deals with deep studies and Ayurveda deals with the deeper studies. For example, there is a pattern in human life. One is, in human life, life is driven by a substance which is Trigunya in nature. Deoxyribonucleic acid, in which the ribo substance is Drudha. Nucleic acid is a Drava and dioxy is Vata, gas. So it is driven by a Trigunya Mula. So you know that everything is composed of elements, and that is composed of a primary element which is known as DNA. This DNA facilitates functioning with composition with RNA, ribonucleic acids, and this creates functional elements known as tissues. These functional elements, they are having specific code, that is Samanya and Vishesha. Vishesha Mulani is known as a tissue and Samanya Mulani is known as a cell. That which has normal activities of human body, such as 1. Transmission of signal, number 2. Reception of signal, 3. Reception of energy, 4. Burning of energy, 5. Death and recycling, mitosis and meiosis, which we call in science. These 5 compositions are very much available in all cells of the body. So they are known as Samanya Mulanu or Samanya Muladrava. So in the Vishesha Muladrava, they are functionally specified that it is an optical tissue, it is a neural tissue, it is an endocrinal tissue, it is an endoplasmic tissue, it is a Golgi body tissue. So it is specified with an organ, organic function, organic zone, mapping area and specific spot. So this type of deeper studies of the modern medicine in understanding the DNA complex, cell complex, tissue network, artificial network, neural network, chromosomal elements, genome mutation and genome messages, that is that modern medicine. There are 5 things. One is DNA, second is a chromosome, third is a gene, fourth is a cell, fifth is a tissue. This is a fundamental study in modern medicine. Deep study. In deeper study, the 3 gunas, panchabhutas, the 3 doshas, satvika, rajasa, tamasa, they are 3 gunas. 3 doshas, they are known to you already. Panchabhutas are known, panchakoshas are known, panchapranas are known. All of these various elements are in the deeper study. Ayurveda starts from deeper study to the tangible study to understand the reality of the disease, its origination and treatment. Whereas modern medicine starts with deep study, what is there in the gene, what is the genome message, where we can make a gene mutation or gene specification or gene driving for understanding the upregulation of a disease, where we can convert, tune, attune, monitor, specify and customize the genes for our disease. Just as recently they have made gene therapy for oral cancer, which they have completely made successful. Like that, to understand that, whatever the Shastra is saying, if you go for an intermediate factor, see, there are two things. One is an intermediator, second is an aboriginator, third thing is a reflector area. Reflected area is human body. Modern science thinks that these intermediators known as chromosomes, genes, DNA, cell tissues are the real aboriginators of diseases or homeostasis. It is not so. Shastra says that even these things are subtle servants. What is the difference between industrial training and IT, information technology, and industrial technology? Both are laborers. But this is a noble labor, and that is known as noble slavery. I used to call it as high-end slavery, and then the people are treated as very normal slaves or normal laborers. So that is the difference between these things. If you are having visible organs, if you are having visible organs like eye or stomach or nose, something, etc., there are visible functionaries of the human body. DNA, gene, chromosomes are invisible, are these subtle things. See, there are two things. One is tangible, tangible. Second thing is subtle, tangible. Third thing is subtle, subtle. Fourth thing is subtle, tangible. The tangible tangible structure of the human body is the organic system, then the gastroenterological system, the endocrinological system, the neural system, the nephral system, the urinal system, the descriptive system of the cognitive things in the endocrine reticulum of human mind, chidakasha, the internal organ. There is a skeletomuscular system, digestive system, distributive system, vertical, circulatory system, excretory system. This thing, everything is tangible, tangible. Second thing is subtle tangible. Chromosomes, genes, DNA, tissues and cells, they are subtle tangible. Still they are tangible, but they are subtle tangible. They are subjected to a different microscopic or endoscopic or laparoscopic vision or surgery. But still they are also tangible. They are subtle tangible. The third thing is tangible subtle. They are subtle but tangible. What are they? The three doshas which we can feel by the pulse. The panchabhutas. They are also subtle in nature, but the subtlety is tangible. The subtle subtle thing is the karmic effect, the karma vibhaga. So Ayurveda deals with the subtle tangible as well as the subtle subtle units, whereas the tangible tangible as well as the subtlety of the tangible things are dealt in modern medicine. So the sukshma and sthula are dealt by these two dynasties, these two traditions, in which sukshma sukshma and sthula sukshma, tangible subtlety and subtle subtlety is dealt in Ayurveda, and subtle tangibility and tangible tangibility is dealt in modern medicine. They consider, even though these parts, like gene chromosomes are there, even though they are subjected to microscopic vision, analysis, everything, etc., something that which is visible to your own eye, that which is perceivable by your own organs, whether with an instrumental eye or without an instrumental eye, that which is perceivable is perishable. That which is perishable is limited. That which is limited will give you only limited information. Unless you understand the limited, unless you understand the unscrutable, you cannot define anything fully. That is the medulla oblongata of Ayurveda technology. So it started with not only understanding of medicine. First of all, human beings, they had all benefits and ill fits of nature. What are the ill fits of nature? First is inconvenience. Second is inability. Third thing is inertia. Fourth thing is collapse or demise. So it started like that. So inconvenience should be substituted by whenever human being felt inconvenience, he wanted something for convenience. So he started taking rest, taking some water, taking some food. So something he started for getting convenience. The second thing is inability. Then he has to mobilize his ability. Third thing is inertia, in which something is not functioning at all. So he has to induce the functioning. Third thing is death. So these are the stages of negative element inside you. Negative element, in the inceptive stage, it creates inconvenience. In the second stage, it creates some sort of restlessness, creating inability and pain. Third thing, it creates inertia and lack of functioning in a particular area. Fourth thing, it results in a fatal end, disease. So there, we are going to substitute the same thing with convenience, ability, activation and survival. These are all the counter forces for these four things. So human beings, in the nomadic period or whatever they are called as civilization period or something else, they started with understanding something to drink with water, something to take rest, something to paste. At the time of the area, initials, they used to do a lot of things. And regarding the global awareness of medicine, there are innumerable schools of medicine. There is Byzantine school of medicine, The ancient African school of medicine was there, Chinese school of medicine, ancient Tibet medicine was there, the Egyptian famous medicines were there. Mummification has been made with these people by preservatives. They know how to remove the brain. They know how to preserve the mummy by removing the removable parts and habitable parts and to preserve the body structure of these departed kings. They know everything, etc. So this mummification, preservation, everything was there. But still there were three schools of thought I want to say. Number one, by means of herbs. Number two, by means of incantations. People thought that at first diseases were taught by the primitive men as influence of some evil things. They did not understand that it is a bodily deficiency or any other defect. At first they understood that they thought that it may be some evil influence. So they tried to worship nature, call on some other evil spirits for service or good spirits for service. So it started in the process of incantation. Worship of things with magic and other things, etc. So first is understanding about herbs, application of herbs. Second thing is abiding with food and nature. Even most of the living beings, when they are getting into some problems, they immediately move from the place, take rest, don't eat anything and cure themselves. So by a natural isolation and inertia, all the animals or most of the species, including human beings, they resorted into health process. One. Number two, by means of medical applications. Number three, by means of incantation. A lot of people still know they practice a lot of mantras, like African this methodology of Udu and Sivudu, Sivare. All of these methods are where they worship with needles, worship with black water, various other things are there. It will take a different session for understanding the superstitions or their superstitions. So this is how the world evolved. At that time, we must probably say that Ayurveda, among the various evolutions of various systems of treatment for human life, for extension of longevity, for preventive methodology, curative methodology, vitalization methodology, as well as composite development methodology of human life, Ayurveda is the first full-fledged emerged form. So if you take even a common civilization understanding, that is a chronological study of evolution, it is known as chronoevolutionary study. If you take that, for example, if you know about something incidentally or accidentally, if it is incidental, for example, if you know about some other herb, you are tasting the herb, actually you are feeling that you are free from headache. It is incidental. Somehow it is accidental. Where it is accidental and where it is incidental, wherever by observation of your own experience or observation of other people you are following, that is incidental. Otherwise it is accidental. For example, I am saying that it takes 1 month for a person to accidentally envision one herb. So, on the basis of this chrono evolution studies, understanding lot of diseases, not only understanding herbs, understanding the disease and connectivity between the disease and herb, as well as understanding the constitution of the body and functioning this. If every month a person understands a concept, a herb and a relativity, for understanding everything it should have taken more than 16,000 years. By incidental study or accident, if it is accidental, then it is time unlimited. Accidentally, if a person is getting something, he may get this year or even the year after, he may get two things in a day. We cannot predict accidental. If a person is having a proper methodology, even in spite of that methodology, even if you count it randomly, it will take 16,000 years to get the configurative study. Because that was incidental, not instrumental. Now we are having instrumental, introspective, then extrospective methodology of studies by which we go inside a human atlas, watch everything. Now you are having virtual reality by which the simulation and modeling of operations as well as physiology and physioanatomy, everything is possible now. So in the period of evolution, I am talking about chrono evolutionary evaluation. It is CEE. As per this civilization mark, certainly it would have taken thousands of years. But Ayurveda, it emerged. For example, you are knowing things, number one. You have to practice the things that you are knowing. You have to experience these practices. Then you have to codify everything. Then language should develop. Everything should be converted into shlokas in the form of padyas. Then it should be instructed to people. Then it should spread. Whatever the books forms we are having now, by Charaka, Sushruta, Madhavanina, Shastra, then various other mythological works of Ashwini, Dhanvantri and various other people, this thing is in the form of a culmination. The saturated version. So this chrono evolutionary process, even before the availability of the Atharvaveda or so called the Vedic Samhitas, where we are having lot of specification about jaundice, heart attack, palpitations, kushta, leprosy, various diseases, vast notifications are being given along with herbs as well as mantras in Atharvaveda. So even if you consider these things as before thousands of years, for the evolution as per the chrono evolutionary evaluation, it would have taken thousands of years more. So such much is the greatness of our Ayurveda. So we have to mainstream it, that is the thing. Already I have attended one seminar which has helped me to conduct this. The second thing is, if you want to create some sort of comparison, there are two comparisons. One is contemporary comparison, second is current comparison. Then comparing to that of the primitive society of Chinese medicine, Tibetan medicine, Byzantine medicine, Incan medicine, Aztec medicine, Mayan medicine, and various other civilizations, medicines, tribal native medicines, as well as incantations and potions that they have practiced and they have administered with a lot of people, which we are having lot of historical records as well as inscriptive evidences. Even we are having thousands of practical evidences with those people who are just endangered now. So, first thing is comparing the contemporary society of Ayurveda, how far Ayurveda is great. That is understandable. Second thing is compare it with present, current, modern medical science, how far is Ayurveda. There are four things. One is number of new diseases. And second thing is there are number of new effective medicines. And the people's mind setup is different, body adaptability is different, the population has grown to a greater extent. That is number three. So, we are having lot of disturbances and differences like that. Number one is more population. Different mind setup of people, different physical adaptability of the people. New diseases they have come. Third thing is new effective drugs are there. Number fourth, new responsible technologies they have emerged. At this time, how we are going to mainstream Ayurveda? How we are going to tackle new diseases in Ayurveda? Number one, how we are going to meet new technologies in Ayurveda? Is it going to be against that? Are going to be complementary to each other? Or create a substitute technology for that? Number four, is it having already an existing technology which is equal or greater than that? These four questions who are going to answer? Is it going to buy or incumbent with the modern technology? Or independent of existence is possible? Or already there is a substitute for that which is greater or equal? These things we have to decide. And new effective medicines, they have come. And the people, their adaptability is entirely different. So this is what we call mainstreaming Ayurveda. Before mainstreaming Ayurveda, you must not compare the contemporary Ayurveda period, but Ayurveda with the current period and current medicine. Most of the people, the greatness of Ayurveda is already proved in its earliest reference. But as effective reference, it is not yet proved. Most of the Ayurvedic colleges and conferences, they are simply like a parrot repeating the same thing, like those people were nomads, they were in nudity and obscurity and that time we developed everything. So earlier reference of medical knowledge, more than the papyrus medical philosophy of the Egypt, more than the Materia Medica philosophy of the West, more than the Byzantine Admira Physiata medicology that existed in the ancient civilizations, more than the Babylonian and Sumerian civilizations perspective of physical anatomical structures that they have made before 4500 years. More than that, we have been advanced and we have developed lot of things like rhinoplasty, plastic surgery, hematology, gynecology, obstetrics, then osteopathy, innumerable things we have developed. Nobody is going to deny that. But effective reference towards the present trend is an area where we have to contemplate. And number two, there are innumerable things with modern and as well as our traditional medical sciences clash. So it is a clash between modernity and our ancestralism. So most of the things they have accepted, few things they have refuted, few things they have not clarified or they have not been clarified. Either they have not clarified or they have not been clarified. Most of the portions are unknown to modern medicine. Most of our Ayurvedic syllabi and the contents are unknown, unexposed to modern medicine. So we have five dimensions. Where they have refuted, where they have appreciated and accepted, where they are not known of anything about that subject at all. Like you say Tridosha, till now they don't understand what is Vata, Pitta and Shleshma. And still apart from a mere pulse meter, they cannot interpret anything from a Nadi. They cannot understand anything from a Nadi, except understanding the palpitation, except understanding the normal cardiac functioning or any respiratory arrest or any other affliction or any other disturbance. They cannot predict something more with the general physical health of human beings. So these things are unknown areas. So accepted area, refuted area, unknown area, accepted and refuted area, refuted and accepted area. So these things are the five divisions which we are gathering with the modern as well as traditional medicinal clash. Now coming to mainstreaming, what is mainstreaming? If you say about mainstreaming, there must be also some other levels. What are they? What is mainstreaming and what is elsewhere other than mainstreaming? There are three things. One is merge, second is substreaming, Third thing is mainstream. Apart from this, there is extinction or obsoleteness. We will leave all of these things. There is mainstreaming. Mainstreaming means, in spite of existence of various entities, if still a thing is dominating, it is a benevolent domination, still something out of its productivity, out of its services, out of its magnanimity and greatness and richness, something that rules the society is in the mainstream. And that which is not there, but still existing as an alternative or complementary, that is known as substream. That which has no identity at all, that which is already a part or already merged as a part in the mainstream, having no individuality or individual identity, that is known as merge. Now Ayurveda is going to merge. Because most of the people, they don't have any, except the syllabus and the place where they sit and study, everything is followed like that of the mainstream of Sri Allopathy only. Their practice, their behavior, their ashram, everything is now slowly getting merged into the mainstream of Allopathy. So to take that submerging system of this Ayurveda into Allopathy, as well as the already existing substream section of Ayurveda to the mainstream, we have to do two things. We have to create the individuality and uniqueness of Ayurveda so that it is not mixed with Allopathy at all. So that thing is not there. Now if you are the student, as well as the scientist, as well as the scholar, if they themselves accept that they need a prosthetic tool or a limb of the Allopathic guidance, then that proves that they are handicapped, that the system is incomplete. So mainstreaming means, number one, philosophy. Philosophy should be clear. Second thing is process. It should be more effective. And the third thing is resources. That is the upadhan. We must have abundant resources, inexhaustible resources. That is the mula dhatu or mula dravya. For Ayurveda, we need lot of herbs, rasa, patana, dhatu, beshaja, aushadha, innumerable things we require. Where are those mula dhatus? It should be abundant. Growing population, growing diseases, then resources should also grow. Now there are three compacts. In cultivation, there are three compacts. Food versus herb versus fuel. Food cultivation versus herbal cultivation versus fuel. Are they going to tackle the food issue by cultivating food crops? Are they going to cultivate jetophon and other things for fuel? This thing, they have to hire Mars and Jupiter. They have to hire Mars, Jupiter, Venus and other planets. Each and every planet they have to use for all of these things. One planet for energy cultivation, one planet for herbal cultivation, one for food. That is the thing, food, fuel and this herbal or medicinal value compact is now existing. How they are going to use it? So it should have a philosophy, it should have a process, it should have the fundamentals, what we call mula dhatus in the form of the resources. Apart from that, public demand. Mainstreaming is not made by any book or by any educational institution. It is made by public demand. Who makes a hero? Who makes a zero as a hero? And still wants the zero to be the hero? Who makes that? It is only the people. Who makes fit for nothing fellow to be a political head or ruler of a nation? Fit for nothing fellow to be a political head or ruler of a nation. This is public demand. So public demand only creates mainstreaming. That public demand will rise. Public demand will rise on various issues like attraction, fascination, incentive, booster, prizes, competition, everything, etc. Some mania is there. Most of the people practicing Ayurveda are going for Ayurveda. We can classify this thing into four types. Beneficiaries of Ayurveda, and number two, maniacs of tradition. And third thing is somebody who is always jumping, who is an alternative amphibian. Such people, they are known as alternative amphibians. Anything that is new, they will get inside. As the Allopathy was new, they got into that. Now as Ayurveda is replenished and reintroduced, it appears to be new. So anything that is Ayurvedic, natural, organic, herbal, now if you put these four names in any brand, even if it is a cow, then people are ready to take. It is also a mania. So we have to understand that people are maniac. That people, those who have exhausted all of their hopes, they go for some solace. Those who are understanding that and going for that. So people with expectation, people with experience, people with hope and exhaustion, and people who will go just for fascination and craze. There are four people in Ayurveda, and don't think that Ayurveda widespread in the world that renounces this Ayurvedic demystification and that pronounces Ayurvedic victory. It is not like that. Most of the people practicing Ayurveda is a danger to Ayurveda, because if it is liberalized, lot of other fake companies will come. Lot of other fake practitioners will come. This thing going to foreign countries is not development. the same time, we have to be very clear, even the Indian people, they are not able to follow that. So it will create lot of certifications, lot of other practitioners, wherein by the real genuinity of Ayurveda will be made debatable. So we have to be clear that while the things are widespread, while the things are made popular and familiar, at the time we have to be careful about the precision and value of practice, which is not there in Ayurveda. Somebody told there are 1,25,000, somebody in before 10 or 15 days, somebody told 1,25,000 yoga practitioners in Canada registered. So qualitatively, does it mention something about great about mystic achievement? It is not so. Most of the people, they may be asana teachers. They will be knowing about 10 or 12 asanas, by which at last they have been given the simhasana to sit in the teacher's seat. They are not clear about the mystic practices and fundamentals. So this is where we have to practice. Then public demand will come, really, number one. Whenever something is cheaper, free of cost, that is affordable. Number two, risk free. Number three, preventive quality should be there. Number four, durable quality should be there. If you take the medicine should not make you to take it every week or every fortnight or every month. That should not develop a bondage, wife and husband bondage between the medicine and the patient. So it should have, number one, durability. If you take the medicine, at least it should immune the system so that you will not get it back for at least 6 months or 1 year. So they will go for something which is cheaper, that is affordable. Second, that which is risk-free. Third thing is that is preventive. Fourth thing, that is durable. Fifth thing, that is composite. That will not only cure the disease, that is greatness of Ayurveda. That will not only cure the disease. Number two, it will activate the inner dynamism so that such diseases will not be created, number one. Number two, it will also cure the connected diseases. That is the greatness of Ayurveda. So they will see whether it is composite in curing also, and also precision in diagnosis and perfection in treatment. These are all the expectations of public. So that which is having these qualities of affordability, risk-freeness or risk reduction, durability, preventability, composite curing, precision in diagnosis and perfection in treatment, that is going to be public demand. So we have to create this public demand competitively, comparatively. This is really mainstreaming Ayurveda. That is with three people. One is students. They should see that they represent the real Ayurveda. They should not represent the degree, but also the dignity of Ayurveda. Everybody is representing the degree of Ayurveda. If they represent the dignity of Ayurveda, certainly it will be there. It is in their hands. Number two, it is in the hands of the teachers. They should see that they develop good practitioners. For the examination, they are correcting something and writing as if it is history or geography. History and geography, it is okay. For example, if somebody says that my hand is shivering a little bit, it is okay. If the person is a clerk or accountant, it may not be the problem. If he is a neurosurgeon and the hands are moving like this as if he has to play some tabla or something, then it is very dangerous. So Ayurveda, that deals with life. You are playing with lives of people. So you must understand the seriousness of the subject and the same mugging of, you cannot deal everything with the same thing. You cannot deal with same thing. For example, science is entirely different, history geography is different, language and non-detail is different. Ayurveda should be read as a penance. It is a tapasya to read Ayurveda and just mugging up with physics, geography or various other studies, whether it is scientific or non-scientific, that is not applicable to Ayurveda at all, because you are understanding life. So you are understanding various other things. You are understanding geography by understanding the surface of earth, by understanding the celestial things and understanding constellations, understanding heat, magnetism. These things are entirely different. Understanding life functioning deficit, life functioning deficit compensation, life extension and life saturation and solution. These are all the studies of Ayurveda. Life functioning deficit replacement and extension of life. Extension of life, then life model, then solution and saturation. I have already told that now. So this is Ayurveda. So you must be more serious, sincere, because it is a sacred mission. But they have made only it as a secret mission by their orismology and other things. They did not consider it to be sacred. So making it as a public demand is possible only by the scholars of Ayurveda, the students of Ayurveda, and dignity should be established by the pharmaceuticals by maintaining the ethicism in practice. That is known as pharmacoethics. They have to mention, also maintain the pharmacoethical standards to bring the dignity of Ayurveda. And it is the duty of each and every son of this land, each and every sage of this land, each and every scholars of this land, each and every pontiff of this land, to safeguard the dignity of our religion, our studies and heritage, to see that these three people are properly doing or not. They have to watch that these three people should practically deal with all of these things. This is known as mainstreaming. Mainstreaming, we have to bring all of these. There are two problems. One, the composers of Ayurveda analyst of Ayurvedas, the invigilators of Ayurvedas, commentators of Ayurvedas, they are all pertaining to a different landscape, that is a different chronological state, a different way of living, different intellectual status, etc. See, just as we are reading about Sushruta, we cannot be Sushruta. You can write about Kumbhakarna, but can you be like Kumbhakarna? You can write about anything, 1 crore, 2 crore, 5 crore, you can write about anything. But you cannot have that stuff, you cannot have that stamina, you cannot have that stagmatism, it is very difficult. So the main problem is, Ayurveda was composed in a different area, in a different field, by different people who adopted a different style of life, who had a different intellectual status. Whenever we are going to bring the same, there is a lack of proper adaptability and compatibility where we are getting a mass cleavage. The proper people, the modern people approaching Ayurveda, they are not so specially talented. They are just kicking themselves for normal talents of going through the books and mastering these things, memorizing these things and writing an examination. Where to come for this lamentable special talent? So that is the problem. The composers, that is the primogenitors of Ayurveda, as well as the novel identifiers of Ayurvedas now, they have a vast value in between them and how to surpass these things. It is one question. And the other thing is, there are two things. One is mythological medicine. And second thing is medical medicine. Ayurveda consists of a lot of mythological works, wherein by Dadichi, his bones have been made into Vajrayuda, and King Vena was dead. And his thigh has been cloned, DNA from his thigh has been cloned to create Prithu Chakravarti. We have a lot of information in mythology. Most of the things in Ayurveda, they are connected with mythology. While we deal with the Charitaka or Pramanika, there are two things. Charitaka deals with mythology, Pramanika deals with the technology. There is a problem in the Ayurveda like that. So most of the things are having deities connection or devatas connection. Something they are telling, some herbs which are available only in celestial planets. They are inducing lack of new mantras. They are inducing new process known as Prana Pratishtha, Shapa Vimochana, Bali Dhana, then Pura Prana Pratishtha, Dikbanda, Vimoga, Kala Nirnaya. Innumerable things are there. You must pluck the herb only at the time. You must chant this mantra, you must tie this thing, you must worship this lady. So everything is like that. So we face the problems like that. Number one, Arismology. Most of the things are in Paribhasha. Now what I told in recently on seminar, I told, there is no need of Paribhashas now. Paribhasha is not essential now, because even if it is transparently told, people are not capable of understanding and practicing. People, even though if clearly you say that this is the thing, people have lost their vigor to truth. No need to hide truth. No need to hide the concepts of Ayurveda. Even if it is plain and transparent, nobody is ready to practice. Number one. And number two, demystification and deification of Ayurveda. Everything is connected with the God and Devata. Everything is connected with the mantra. So unless these things are understood, either you have to remove them and understand the herbs properly. Or if it is essential, if you consider, you must behave like that, you must practice that. You are practicing everything in the Rasasala, Rasayana Sala. But in the Antaryana, you have to practice Nididhyasana, Upasana, Pujana, and everything, etc. If you believe that, practice. If you don't believe, remove that and extract and create a de novo system of Maitreya Medita, in which there is no Devata, Mantra, Pujana, Vidhi, Niyama, Achara, and Samskara. You remove all of these things. That is the second thing. Third thing is pulse diagnosis. For example, I want to say something. If you want to mainstream something, productivity must be assured. If productivity should be assured, diagnostic system should be assured. If diagnostic system is to be assured, then understanding of the system should be assured. If you don't have understanding of body, nature, the birth, etc., your diagnosis will be wrong, because the basic understanding of the system itself will be wrong. If the understanding of the system is wrong, your diagnosis is wrong. If your diagnosis is wrong, the treatment is wrong. If the treatment is wrong, productivity is wrong. I conduct a seminar within 1 or 2 months, in which there are challenge all of you people, you are all admirers of Ayurveda. With you I cannot conduct that. 100 questions in Ayurveda which can be asked by these material Vedita people, modern people, which we have to answer. I believe that nobody can answer, only few people they can answer. Pulse diagnosis, you have to prove, already I have told in 2 seminars, that you have to create a reverse simulation system or modeling system, wherein by you have to understand the micro levels of signals which are classified into main level, sub-level and sub-sub-level classifications, where we can understand which part it is reflecting. That sound reflects which part, which organ, which zone, which nerve and which part it is going to reflect. That it should be understood only by a reverse process. So by understanding this nadi and coming to a mechanical calculation or determination will take you hundreds of years. Nobody is now so capable to do that. So if you go by the reverse process, you understand the diseases first by a normal medical report, modern medical report, and try to interpret try to connect the pulse signals with the available medical report. Then you can produce medical reports after 50 or 100 exercises. I have suggested it in 2 seminars. Somebody should do that. One more problem is there. Hundreds of problems. In Ayurveda, whatever they have told about the Sharira and various other things, they are totally incongruous to that of the modern medicine things. I will say one example. It is about gender determination. That is, Shukla Adhikyena Puman. Shwanita Adhikyena Strisyat. It is there in Shastras. Where the male content is more, the child will be male, and female content is more dominant, it will be female. But there is a very great opposition. One person in flight at Banaras, he has talked to me for 1.5 hours. According to modern science, the XY and XX system, as well as the XX, XO system, and the ZW system, 3 systems are there, apart from haplodiploids. Haplodiploids is the 4th system. Apart from which, there are 3 systems. According to that, sex determination range Y is known as sex determination range Y syndrome is that it is known as SRY. This SRY, which is having 60 million of base pairs, when it combines with something of its own kind, it becomes female, XX. If it is with Y, XY, it becomes a male. And the adaptability of X with a male, as well as XY being bivalent inside a male, if the X combines with the X of the female, it will be a female. If the X of the male combines with the Y, it will be a male. Like that, the second option I have told, it is XX giving you, XO giving you. XX, it gives you female. XO means that O, it will not have a secondary sex determination factor. Secondary sex determination factor, SSDF will not be there. It is a second model. It is available in few cockroaches, grasshoppers and some elements. It is available, XX, XO model. The second is contrary. ZS, yes, ZZ, that gives you male. XX gives female. But ZZ, that gives male. Z and W, that gives female. Apart from haplodiploids. So this is what the modern oology, spermatology, genetic engineering, life organization science, they say only like that. But Ayurveda has not told like that. Like that, we can give thousands of examples. But the Shastra say that Adhikya, if you say predominance, it means not the predominance of the fluid or the content or something. It is predominant of the factor. It is predominance of the factor. For example, a human being is bivalent. In male structure, it is having 2 things. One, it is having an option to create a male or female. It is having an option to create a male or female. And the female is having only the compatibility to access the male to be subjected to create a male or female. You found that? That is, compatibility is with the female, and the compatible design structure, which is more qualified for male and female, X and Y, is rested with male. This Adhikya deals with the force. Adhikya need not be the substance. It is dealing with the force. So whenever a male, in his XY standard, XY is the male standard, whenever a person imposes the same XY model, joining with the X of the female, XY is a male model, in this Adhikya, XY with the Y with the X model is XY model. That is a natural innate model of male. But here, in your fusion, that innate model is bi-represented. The innate represented model of male is XY. The fusion representation is also XY if the person is male. But the difference is, in that innate model, the X belongs to his own chromosomal status. And in the fusion model, the X belongs to the female status. But XY is the Adhikya of the Purusha Tattva, so it is becoming male. That XX, it gives the female. So Adhikya means not substance, it is not substance domination, but substantial domination, so it is possible. I think that it requires more lights to be thrown and more discussions in later. Likewise, hundreds of visible transparent incongruities are there. If somebody asks a question, the Ayurvedic student or a scholar must be able to answer all of these questions. The other thing is microanatomy. Where is the chakra? Where are the points inside? All of these things are also very mysterious and known only through yoga and realization. Everything you say that you do penance, you will realize. You go to forest, close your eyes, you will realize. Then that should be practiced only in forest. So practicality, see, if you can show 50% by practical demonstration, even though not the base, but the effective functioning, other than 50% can be inferred. That is known as logical inference. If your thing is very much acceptable by perception, which is very much empirically practicable, rest of the things which are impalpable can be guided by logical inference, provided that there are two things. One is perceptibility, second is empiricism. I am seeing these things. Okay, 25% given. I am experiencing the benefits, 25% given. If 25, 50% is given, other 50% you need not experiment at all. You can just understand by means of logical inference. So this is what we have made, a clear cut logical inference, where we can have perceptibility, number one. You have to classify our value into three portions: perceptible portion, empirical portion, and portions which are guided by experiential study or logical inference. So you classify all of these things. If you are strong and solid in these two areas, you can easily govern any rationalist at any area by that. It is possible. Then coming to treatment. Treatment, as you see, there is some common ethical problems with all people, whether it is homeopathy, allopathy, radio anesthesia, then magnetotherapy, crystal healing, whatever it may be. There are some hurdles. One is mistake of conception. Second is mistake of dialysis or diagnosis. The third thing is aimless scrutiny or aimless never-ending journey of research. People will be doing lot of research. Now they told that it was cell, then they told it was genes. What is going on like that? You have to mute your gene and get the benefit. So it is going on like that without any end at all. So the first problem is misconception. Second is problem in diagnosis. The third thing is aimless, endless, directionless scrutiny or research that you are doing. Fourth thing is, now we are beating a lot of other fake medicines, duplicated medicines. Fifth thing is dangerous medicines. Most of the medicines are dangerous. They are drowsifiers and they are somnolizers. They are decapacitators of your physical strength and ability, most of the medicines. That's why I told you in the seminar, empty means a mentor of dangers. Because each and every medicine that not only disturbs the disease and aggravates, creates also, invades also the sisters and brothers of the already existing diseases. That is the problem. And the other thing is fraudulent practice, unethical practice like organic trade and other things. And side effects. There is one more thing you have to understand. It is saturate efficacy. What is it? Saturate efficacy. If you take a medicine for 10 days, then afterwards it does not work. Then it will go against us even. That's why I told in one pharmaceutical seminar, any medicine that is non-systematically, that is manufactured, that which is not a composite vision's product, it will come like a hero to safeguard you, will become a comedian, will turn against you as a villain. So it will take the three musketeers dimension. This is known as saturant efficacy, whereby the medicines will not work out at all. And the final thing is cryptonymity. I don't know anything about the disease. World Health Organization and various other institutes, they have given a list of unidentifiable diseases and syndromes. Thousands of diseases, they are not identifiable, detectable, trackable, definable and curable. That is there. This thing is a common problem in all allopathy, homeopathy and other things along with Ayurveda, which we cannot work. Finally, I want to say two things. Number one is, whenever you are dealing with medicines, I want to give three solutions. One is by application of bioinformatics. Second thing is transgenic confirmation of medical plants. Third thing is pharmacopoeia. I need that whenever there is possible, we can have a very great workshop in that with some more scholars. I deliver a lecture about pharmacropping and ICRISAT is interested in organizing a very big seminar at Bangalore, very big international seminar at Bangalore in the month of June in pharmacropping. What is bioinformatics? Most of the herbs mentioned in the Shastras, they are having a lot of problems. Number one, the same name is given to a lot of herbs. Different herbs have the same name. Number two, same herb, they have different names. Number three, the quality of the particular herb cannot be got similarly in all areas. Only some area has that potency. Fourth thing, the same herb has innumerable varieties and which to select, where to apply, we don't know about that. Number fifth thing, due to bio as well as geodegradation, they are not easily available, fully nutrient in nature. Fifth thing, they are not easily cultivable. Most of the things are growing, scarce, faded and put into obsoleteness. After 10 years, you will not get major proportions of the very famous drugs which we are going to use predominantly in drug manufacturing. These seven problems are there in the gut system, for which I want to mention bioinformatics. If you understand the protein sequence and proteinic expression of all of these things, you can create either identical boosting or parallel boosting or similar boosting of protein links and substances which can be used with bio-nanotechnology or biotechnology which can be used as medicines. Number one, transgenic plants. These plants, most of the plants which we are having now, they they are not adaptable to any altitude, temperature, soil level, salinity, water level, humidity, etc. If they are made transgenic, they can be made into hyperactive, more productive, shorter in size, having more rotary cycles, acceptable to drought and overwater, having water retention, temperature retention, inbuilt pest resistance, everything can be tuned inside by means of taking into a transgenic process. Third thing is farmacropping. Very wonderful thing. Nobody is interested. I have to just lament on myself. 100 square feet is more than enough to induce. For example, you take the microbial nutrient or protein level or the essential level of anything like Dithales omnivora. Induce it with Oryza sativa, that is rice. You mix it in the plant cell level or basic level, parental level, and create a sapling for that. Take a petri dish, cultivate and fuse them, both of them, and you create a new model, a new generation model. So this type of thing is known as farmacropping, which the world is now trying to understand. By making farmacropping, even a limited inducible element of these herbs can be mixed with wheat, barley, sesame, mustard, and other farmer consumables which we are normally using, that will create a lot of other new revolutions in the herbal industry connected with food industry. So this is known as farmacropping. So somebody should, either I think that we should conduct a seminar on farmacropping, transgenic plants or transgenic systems to be inculcated or instilled in the herbal studies, as well as we have to understand about bioinformatic systems of protein multiplication, monitoring and simulation, and modeling of structures. Reflexive structures and reflective structures of these herbal plants. Under these things are done, I have already told about the trilateral combat of fuel, fundamental and food. That is herbs, the food consumption and fuel. We are not going to cultivate these things. Very difficult to adapt to our circumstances. We have to do this. Very essential. One more thing I want to say is, there are some four major disturbances with Ayurveda. It is treating with Loha, Dhatu, Rasa and Pashan. Rasa is Mercury, Dhatu is minerals and ores, and Loha are heavy metals, and Pashana is with toxins. And for that, what I want to say is, it is also a nano processing. It is a process by which the functional structure, it is not the structural nano processing like 10 to the power of minus 9 of a meter is a nanometer, what I told today. It is not like that. It is the functional nano engineering by which the energy of a particular element, three things is done. One, the mala, visha, and daunabhaga, it is removed. Mala is the wastage, visha is the toxic thing, and third thing is gauna, the trivial things, they are released. Number two, the innate potency is revealed. The innate natural potency, losing the identity of ferrum, copperum, argentinum, all of these metals, they lose their structural identity and claim their functional identity. That is the second step. And first step, I already told, unwanted things are removed. Second thing, losing the identity, only wanted things are projected. Third thing, the projected energy is multiplied into billion times. That is known as calyx. Swarna basma or rajata basma, whatever it is multiplied, manifold, multifold, billion times it is multiplied. For that, unless you have two things, one is a certifier, second thing is a detector. By means of human perception of puta, then pakva, paripakva, sampakva, vivechana, shodhana, parikshakarana, niriksha, all of these things are impossible. How to develop with these people who are struggling for even 5 years? How they will get the patients required for 50 years? It is very difficult with these younger generation. So you detect two machines. One is a certifier that it has been fully calcified and no metallic trace is there. Only the qualitative functional impairment is there, losing the identity of the structure of ferrum, argentinum, etc. It is certifier. Detector is done at the time of process and certifier is after the process. Post-processive identification by that. Unless you make these things, very difficult for us to maintain these things in the mainstream. Finally, at Nagpur, somebody told, is a very close friend of yourself, where I stayed two times, I don't know his name at all. Yes, he knows also. There he told that after this 5 year study, one more advanced or one more, what we call, some deeper learning in Ayurveda should be administered for 5 years. Then I told her, already these 5 years, everybody is like feeling like punishment and imprisonment. How? See, learning for 10 years was very casual. Learning means, what is learning? Learning is mastering for 10 years. For anything 10 years, 12 years, it is very casual. Now it is not so. Learning is 1 month, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, everything has become very short. So now, there are four models I told. First model is, after studying these 5 years, once more 5 years, they have to replenish and recharge their knowledge by advanced learning, provided they are interested, number one. Number two is, these 5 years with 1 year of advanced rigorous training in pharmaceutical preparation, diagnosis and treatment methodologies. 5+1. Third thing, even in the 5 years, we have to introduce a special syllabus, a special training which is possible. Fourth thing is possible only by me. I have told several times, nobody will believe. These 5 years can be completed in 1 year, getting the 10 years of experience and precision, which I used to say in all of my lectures. It is very, very easily possible. So these are the things we have to make a mainstreaming Ayurveda by making 5+5, 5+1, or enriching the 5, or some divine learning or divine crash learning fire course. By 1 year studies, we have to do that. Finally coming, political demand or political organization is also very important. For example, still now, China that gives subsidies for traditional Chinese practitioners, and the government that markets, manufactures, deals and gives aid only to traditional Chinese medicine. Whether they are provable by science, understandable or not, they are not bother about these things. They are not go for too much of rationalism. They believe in the system and do that. Still they are hale and healthy. Most of the people are having good longevity and they have reported good treatment benefits. Still they are manufacturing, marketing, everything. So, like the government should be interested in the pride. It should be having some sort of dignity. This type of lobby, allopathy lobby, they are having thousands of crores of rupees to bribe people, to boost people for their favor and for suppressing other technologies, which is what we are experiencing now. Political demand can be brought only by a stronger public demand. Stronger public demand will be created only by this type of mainstreaming exercises, which is there in the minds of scholars, students and pharmaceutical preparers, which should be there by the task force of great personalities. They have to pray, they have to guide the society to get all of these benefits. So I want to give 3 different divisions for Ayurveda. Are you going to be techno-dependent, techno-independent or traditional? I believe that the 3 systems are very much available for the society and essential. If you want to go for technical, go for bioinformatics, go for transgenetics and grow for the process of pharmacropping with herbs, go for pulse diagnosis, reverse detection method, go for certification and detection of calcification of metals, you go for technology. For those people who are technically minded, go for the fusion of Ayurveda with technology, number 1. Those people separate. Their education should be separate, environment should be separate, teaching, gadgets, syllabus, everything should be separate. Second thing is I am technology independent. I want to go with Hatha, Dhruta, Rasa, Rasayana, Nadi Pariksha, everything, etc. I want to be just a traditional. Your thing is entirely different, you practice that. The third thing is traditional. Yes, I believe that there is a Devata, there is Pratyabhimani Devata, there is Abhimani Devata, there is Mula Devata, Dravyabhimani Devata, and there is a mantra, there is a niyama, there is achara, vidhi, diksha, acharya, bhagavan, karma, mula karma, punya, papa, janma, marana, punarjanma, moksha. I believe in the system, I practice it with vigorance, and I get that energy. I believe that apart from my medical practice, metamedical practice, by the use of my knowledge, by the use of my vigor, by the use of my prayer, I believe that I can do lot of wonders. So if you believe that, you believe that. So taking a singular Ayurvedic system at this time is idiocy, it is a small idiocy, it is a distant idiocy. Accepting this technology, create a different school of thought. Independent of technology, create a different school of thought. Traditional Ayurvedic healing, create a different school of thought. If these 3 schools emerge, they can embrace different sections of the society. Suitable persons will come for suitable models and designs. They can create wonders in society. This is the only way, one and only way for mainstreaming Ayurveda in the society. I believe that the day has come. And finally, people like you are feeling that you are not being encouraged by people. People like us, we are feeling that we are not encouraged by people. You are not encouraged by people because of lack of resources. Whereas I am having every resources, financial, intellectual, mental, commitment, all resources are there. If you are not utilizing these things properly as a syllabus, as a system of installation and establishment. What is installation? You must take it inside your mind, it is installation. You must make it in your school, that is installation. You must make it as a syllabus for everybody, that is establishment. This is the only way for mainstreaming Ayurveda. The purpose is known, the process is known, the design has been announced now. If you are not doing, the guilt is yours, blemish is yours, and there is nothing left. Narayan, Narayan.